Hello listeners, welcome to NIOS. Today we are going to do senior secondary level course in sociology. I'll be introducing the chapter on acculturation, assimilation and integration. Students, as you remember, in the previous lesson, we did the social processes, basically where we concentrated on competition, conflict and cooperation. Now, these three social processes talked about the interaction between the individuals and groups. Today, we are going to do social processes basically concentrating on acculturation, assimilation and integration. These three social processes basically concentrate on social change or the cultural aspect of the society as a whole. Now, we'll be discussing one by one in detail. The first social process we are going to talk about is acculturation. As I mentioned earlier, we are going to talk about all these three social processes related to the concept of culture. In other words, they bring about change in the cultural pattern of the society. That is, they are related to the way in which the way of life changes because of interaction. Now, the first slide, or rather in the first section, we are going to talk about the concept of acculturation. Acculturation basically means the transmission of cultural elements from one social group to another. This basically happens because when two different forms of cultures come together, for example, a North Indian culture and a South Indian culture. We all know that these two cultures difference in terms of food, in terms of dress, in terms of language, in terms of the other aspects which highlight the cultural process. So what happens is, when these two cultures, that is the individuals, when they come together, or rather when they interact with one another, they might try to take or imbibe the cultural practices of one group from the others. Now, this often happens because of modern transport, that is the communications or the transport. Why? Because what happens is people travel a lot, people come together a lot, plus also the media plays a very, very important role through televisions. Often what happens is you sit, you watch, you like something, that is you like the way of life of another, you tend to adopt. We often see this in terms of dress, clothing, etc. Now, very briefly, we'll discuss about the characteristics of acculturation. Characteristics of acculturation. One, acculturation could either be conscious or it could be unconscious process. Now, the conscious process could be when you are aware about what you're actually trying to borrow from the other. Now, remember, as I said, that in acculturation, when two groups come together, they do not lose their identity. In the sense that each one of them preserves their own identity. I hope you all know what is identity. Identity is that when you be alike, that is when you try to imbibe what you already have, the identity with which you are forming your identicalness, that is the expressions. Fine? Okay. Now, what I said was that acculturation could be conscious, it could be unconscious. Now, what happens is sometimes people tend to borrow certain things consciously. That is, they are aware of the fact that they are imbibing or they are taking the element from the other. It could be in the form of food, it could be in the term of language. Sometimes you, because you want to be a part of a culture, you tend to do that. Sometimes what happens is this can be unconscious also. That is, you are not aware of the fact that you are trying to borrow from the others. The second very important characteristics is that sometimes what happens is the groups which are involved, they tend to change slightly. I'm not saying totally, but slightly they might change. That is, what happens is they may try to imbibe very slowly what the other culture is. And this happens often because one wants to improve, or rather they feel that it is very important that they should come off more firmly with their identity. Now, another very important characteristics of acculturation is, remember, it does not take place overnight. That is, it is a continuous process. It takes a lot of time. That is, members, when they come together in the form of communities, when they try to imbibe or rather take each other's cultural traits, it takes certain time. Why? Mainly because, first, one has to understand. Two, they have to slowly try to imitate it. And three, want to actually accept it. So, therefore, I repeat myself that it takes a slight a longer time than the usual time. Another very important characteristic of acculturation is that it is either direct or it could be indirect. That is, you can directly come in contact with someone, take it, adopt it, or it could be indirect. Indirect is usually seen in terms of films, in terms of television, serials, because many a times when you watch a movie or when you're watching a serial, it tends to show in an elaborate manner the cultural practices of one particular community. That may be impressive, that you may like to adopt, so therefore you tend to borrow that. Sometimes what happens is, then when you look at your own cultural practices, that is your own way of life, you may feel that there is something lacking, or maybe you want to improve upon it, so you tend to borrow it from the others. Now, the other very important characteristics which you must all remember is that acculturation is a precondition of assimilation or integration. That is, acculturation, that is when two groups come together, when two communities come together, when they try to borrow some things, sometimes what happens is when the borrowing becomes slightly more, it might turn out to be another social processes called assimilation or integration. These two concepts we'll be discussing later. Here, now we discuss another point, that is assimilation. Assimilation is when two cultures come together, borrow, and then they fuse so much that each one of them loses their identity and they come up with a new identity. That is, a new group is formed altogether. Now, you often keep hearing about US, that is United States. United States is a beautiful example where it tends to assimilate all other cultures and a new culture gets emerged. So, what happens is that the Indians who go from here, they tend to live in neighborhood of Americans, they tend to adopt to their consumption patterns, dressing pattern, and slowly and steadily, they tend to lose their own identity. That is what is assimilation. Now, what happens is assimilation is a very beautiful example for development or cultural change. Remember, as I said in the previous lesson also, now also, listeners, you must understand that society is never static. Society is dynamic. It changes. It changes sometimes slowly. It changes sometimes in a very rapid pace. And this always happens when two cultures come together. And that is what we are discussing here, the whole social interaction between two different cultural communities. And here, specifically, we are talking about assimilation. Now, assimilation, as I said, is when the groups lose their identity, their originality. This often happens because of migration. Why? Mainly because when you migrate from one place to another place, you get more accepted if you are a part of that cultural pattern. And sometimes it happens that in a second generation, that is, the parents tend to migrate, they might retain their identity, but the children who are born later in a different land altogether, they tend to adapt themselves to a new way of life. And therefore, what happens is they start identifying themselves from a different culture from what their parents were. And that way, what happens is they tend to completely fuse together into a new society, and therefore, they become a part of that culture. And that is what is assimilation. Now, before we discuss the various examples, let's very quickly, briefly talk about the characteristics of assimilation. Assimilation takes place without any deliberate or the conscious efforts on the part of the groups involved. I repeat myself, what happens is assimilation is an unconscious process. Why? Mainly because when you go into a new place, in order to be completely part of the new, what happens is to be more alike, like that is like-mindedness, you tend to live your cultural patterns and adopt to a new society altogether. Therefore, I again repeat, one of the most important characteristics of assimilation is that assimilation is unconscious. It's a deliberate one. Why? Mainly because you want to lose your previous identity. Now, usually, the second very important characteristic is that usually assimilation takes a long time to materialize. That is, what happens is, first, the two cultures have to come together, they have to come in contact with one another, then they have to learn each other's way of life, then they have to practice that, then adapt. So that takes a lot of time. And when they melt into a new culture altogether, to live their old identity takes a lot of time. So I repeat myself, that is, assimilation takes a lot of time to happen. The third very important characteristic is that assimilation always takes place between two unequal communities. Now, when I say two unequal communities, remember, it is very difficult to actually rank one culture over above the other culture. That is very tough. So, what we are basically trying to talk about is that in the level of development, because sometimes what happens is that the technically or technologically one society may be higher than the other. So, here we are only talking about the fact, the material culture. Many a times we do not take into consideration, I said many a times, at times it's possible, many a times we do not take into account the non-material aspect, that is the ideas and attitude. Why? Mainly because ideas and attitude may be very specific to one culture, which may be culturally very relevant. So, it is very difficult for a student of sociology to say that it is something where that is one culture is above the other culture. All I am talking about is in terms of the material aspect. Sometimes the technology could be develop faster, so therefore you want to cope up with that, so you may adopt yourself to that cultural pattern. So therefore, I repeat myself that assimilation always happens between unequal ranking societies. The very important characteristic is that assimilation is not a temporary one. It's something which is lasting and it happens forever. That is, once you lose your old identity, you can never retain that. So, you adopt to a new identity. So, your identity completely changes. So, remember, assimilation is when you lose your previous identity and form a new identity. And one beautiful or very good example of assimilation is American society. The third very important social process which we are going to discuss is integration. Now, integration is a process when the groups come together as a single unit, they tend to integrate, that is, they tend to remain together and force people to work together. Why? Mainly because integration is very essential for cultural growth, for any society to grow. And society always, as I said, grows from simple to complex, from homogeneous to heterogeneous. So, therefore, it is very, very important that there should be integration. Why? Mainly because integration brings about satisfaction. Groups are formed to satisfy the needs of individual members. I repeat myself, it is very, very important that the groups which are formed, the communities which are formed, are having or giving their members or the society a sense of security, a sense of belongingness, a sense of a similar category. So, therefore, what happens is integration becomes very, very essential. Now, we discuss about the components of integration. Components means the different parts. It is very, very essential for us to understand the components of integration, mainly because sharing of common characteristics facilitates group solidarity resulting from division of labor, reciprocal relationships and interdependency. Now, this aspect of division of labor because of integration is explained very clearly by our founding sociologist, that is Emile Durkheim. Now, Emile Durkheim in his book Division of Labor very clearly explains that due to specialization and development, it is very essential that there should be a division of labor. Now, remember what he says is that the division of labor, or for that matter, solidarity, is there both in simple and in complex societies. In simple societies, we have mechanical solidarity. That is, what happens, it's like a word, mechanics. Mechanical solidarity comes from the word mechanics, like it's automatic. What happens is, have you seen the earthworm? In the earthworm, what happens is divided very equally into different parts. Even if you cut some part and throw it away, it still functions. So, society, that simple societies, homogeneous societies, can be compared to an earthworm. And they say that, you know, that everything is so similar. Why? Because they cannot afford to be different. And there what happens is, it becomes very, very essential that all the groups, communities, or the individuals should integrate with one another for development of the society, for society to be together. Remember, according to Durkheim, sociology is the study of social facts, the study of solidarity. That is one of the most important aspect is for people to remain together, to integrate with one another. So he explains this in simple society with the concept of mechanical solidarity. Now, as the society becomes more and more complex, as in it becomes more heterogeneous, what happens is, again, because of specialization, though the groups are different, they also come together. And here he explains this more clearly by comparing a society to a living organism. And he says there is organic solidarity. Now, what is organic? Organic is like a human body. That is, the way the body is divided into various parts, where each part performs a specialized function. Similarly, what happens is, in a society which is divided into various institutions, each institution performs a specialized role, and because of that, there is interdependency. So, therefore, what happens is, people interact because they are different, and then they integrate in order to take the society to the next level of development. Now, why did we discuss this? We discuss basically to understand the relevance or the importance of integration in the society, integration as a social process. So, coming back, I repeat again, the components of integration is the sharing of common characteristics. Two very important component is acceptance and observation of various norms set by the group is another unifying factor. That is, you need to accept, you need to observe the groups, and then they come together. Another very important component is the component of ethnocentrism. I hope you remember the concept of ethnocentrism we studied in the previous lesson. If not, I'll repeat myself. Ethnocentrism is the preference, that is, you always tend to judge your culture or your cultural practices as the most superior, and then keeping yours as the main, you tend to judge the others. Now, when you're talking about integration, you often try to use this, that is, the preference for one's own culture among the members of the group. Fine. Next, very important component is discipline among the members, because discipline unites the group. If you unite, or rather if you have a discipline, the group remains together. So, therefore, what did we discuss? We discussed the components of integration. Now, remember, the principal factors affecting integration of a group are interdependent activities, consensus and morale. That is, group cohesion and integrations are very important, and they are strengthened by the mutual satisfaction and not alone by social interaction. Factors affecting integration. Now, what are the factors which actually influence the integration? A, size of the group. That is, it is easier to integrate if the groups are smaller. It takes a lot of time, or rather it's sometimes impossible if the groups are large. So, therefore, what happens is, while affecting the group interaction, what is very important is the size of the group. Two, the primary group has greater potential to integrate. What do you mean by primary group? Primary group would mean the face-to-face interaction, that is a group where you are having face-to-face interaction. So, I repeat myself, the primary group has greater potential to integrate. Now, what is very important is the relationship between physical mobility and group integration. This is again a very, very important factor, and also what is very important is to recognize the relationship between homogeneity and integration. Now, what happens is mobility introduces, you can say, a stranger into the group, and the problem is how to assimilate him without actually harming, or rather without actually discouraging or being negative to the group. So, what happens is that it is very important, the larger the proportion of the newcomer, the greater is the resistance of the established group to their integration. Characteristics of integration. Now, integration is a very complex process in comparison to the other social processes which we discussed, that is acculturation and assimilation. Why? Mainly because what happens is two different cultural groups coming together who actually were very, very different now to interact with each other or integrate with one another, as we can always say or see and observe, is a difficult task, or rather we can say it's a complex. There is a difference between difficult and complex. Now, it is complex mainly because it requires structural adjustment on the part of the groups involved. Structural means what it is composed of, what it is made up of. So, therefore, what happens is that it becomes a little more complex mainly because of the structural differences. So, structural adjustment of course takes a lot of time. So, therefore, what happens is the communities of groups which undergo the changes in terms of some of the institutions, whereas they retain the traditional features and practices in case of other institutions. After discussing the characteristics of integration, it is very important for us to understand the similarities or the differences between the three social processes. A comparison between the three social processes, that is acculturation, assimilation and integration. A comparison could mean that how do we look at these three concepts. Now, remember, all these three concepts, as I mentioned earlier, are the social processes. That is, they are continuous, ongoing and very, very important for cultural changes or cultural contact. So, the basic principles of culture contact are acculturation, assimilation and integration. That is the first similarity. As I said, borrowing and acquiring various cultural traits are common among all three. That is, they tend to borrow, they tend to integrate, they tend to adapt to each other. So, that is what is also very, very important. The other three, as I said, the other very important point for comparison is that they always talk about acceptance and adoption of different degrees. All three of them talk about cultural contact, borrowing of cultural traits, but of course the time involved is there and it varies. But then at the very fact that they all believe in cultural contact is the shows that they are similar in one way or the other. The differences between the three of them. Now, assimilation refers to the fusion of cultural traits. You understand what is a fusion? Fusion is when the two come together and completely fuse into one. That is what is assimilation. Acculturation relates to transmission of cultural element, that is just the borrowing, sometimes very good ones, sometimes in order to imitate, in order to be a part and parcel, you just tend to borrow and be a part of the wider society. Whereas integration is what happens is when the members are brought together, they tend to maintain cohesiveness and solidarity. It brings about stability to the group. So, integration brings about stability to the group. So, that is what is the first difference. I repeat myself, assimilation, fusion, acculturation, transmission or borrowing, and integration is to bring about stability. The other very important differences between the three of them is that of course all three of them are continuous, but acculturation is a continuous process as against integration and assimilation. Why? Because acculturation is just that you do not tend to change your identity. So when you do not change your identity, it does not become a threat to your identity. So therefore, there is a preference for this. The process of assimilation takes a long period compared to the other two, that is the fusion of different cultural values and ethos. As against this, integration refers to cultural pluralism. What do you mean by cultural pluralism? Cultural pluralism is when you have different forms of cultural traits. That is, say for example, in terms of the dress pattern in South India, the way the sari is worn is different. That is, somewhere lay more emphasis on the border, somewhere on pallu, somewhere maybe wear on the right side, some may wear on the long side. So therefore, what happens is you have a different cultural practices. So therefore, what happens is that in order to adapt or in order to be a part of it, it takes a lot of time. As against this, integration refers to the cultural pluralism, voluntary and incomplete assimilation. This takes place in a shorter period of time. Acculturation at times is apparent and causes quick social change. So I repeat myself, the process of assimilation takes a long time. Acculturation is apparent and causes quick social change. You understand what is social change? Social change is when a person in a society or a community or a society changes over a period of time from one cultural practice to another cultural practice. Cultural relativism is when you try to judge the cultural practices of your own in relation to the other. So while talking about these social processes which are related to the concept of culture, it is very important for us to understand few concepts. Concepts of cultural lag, concepts of cultural relativism, concept of ethnocentrism, because these are all related to the way in which you try to look at your own cultural practices, your own society. So an understanding of these three social processes becomes complete when you are able to understand these concepts. Now, the concept of cultural relativism, we discussed. The concept of cultural pluralism, we just discussed. Ethnocentrism, we discussed. Cultural lag is something I think I should repeat. Cultural lag is because every culture has two components, the material culture and the non-material culture. The material culture refers to technology. The non-material culture refers to ideas, attitude, opinions. And many a times what happens is the technology, that is the material culture, moves faster than the non-material culture. Why? Mainly because I'll give you a very simple example. Now what happens is washing machine came much before, then the idea of washing clothes by hand and keeping the fact that since clothes are your own personal belongings, you would prefer to wash it on your own. But then washing machine, is more expensive, but less time consuming. So the whole idea of adapting to that takes some time. I'll give you another very beautiful example of how the toilets earlier, people used to say that the toilet should never be inside the house. But over a period of time, they started coming inside the house. And now it is that each one prefers to have their own toilets. When the guests come, the first question which is asked is, who is going to use they will use which toilet? So that is what the whole concept of cultural change is all about. So this is how the whole concept of cultural contact, or rather you can say material and non-material culture, is seen, and the lag between these two is what is referred to as cultural lag. Why I talked about all these concepts is that while understanding the concept of assimilation, acculturation and integration, we must remember these three concepts or these four concepts which I just discussed. Now the last very important difference between the three is assimilation is considered as a very natural product, very natural process, is unassisted process, whereas acculturation and integration are social processes which are assisted by cultural contact and can be promoted directly. I repeat myself, where assimilation to a large extent is very natural, the other two concepts are unnatural and they are done openly because of cultural contact. And remember one thing, the cultural changes in the society has happened mainly because of A, globalization, B, modernization, modernization in terms of media, modernization in terms of the way in which people have started interacting with one another. Now, summing up, all I would say is that these three concepts are very, very relevant in this modern era. Why? Mainly because in modern era, because of high consumption, travel, migration has started happening very frequently and at a very large scale. That is, people tend to move from one area to another area voluntarily, involuntarily. Development is happening at a very fast pace. So, in order to cope up with that, people tend to interact, move very, very fast with each other. So, communities come in contact with one another. Media has played a very, very important role in trying to bring different cultural communities together. Thank you. I hope you have understood today's lesson, the lesson on acculturation, assimilation, and integration.